The following program contains graphic language, which may be offensive to some viewers.
Now I can genuinely say I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
And do things, and people can be like, that's not nice. And you just look at your skeletal, I'm not nice.
Welcome back. Episode, what episode is this? Episode 18?
No.
19?
19 or 20.
You sure?
I'm positive. We've done 18. No, it's 20. It is 20. Because it was 19 Epstein.
No, that was 17. 17 Epstein.
Okay.
Episode 17 Epstein. And then we did...
18.
Did we do 18?
Yeah.
Are you sure? Episode 18 or 19? We don't know.
What are you, fucking retarded?
We're not sure.
We finally reached the moment where we don't know how many.
We actually don't know. It's either going to be episode 18 or episode 19. Welcome back.
We're episode LateTeen.
LateTeen. Yeah. LateTeen. Delinquent Chronicles.
2000 and late.
2000 and late. Yeah. That's what we're going to call it. Episode 2000 and late. We don't know. We're actually lost. I know we got 17 coming out. And I don't know if we recorded 18 afterwards. Or
yeah, we did
18. No, I actually think this is 18. Yeah, I think this is 18.
Okay.
Okay, let's say LateTeen, but I think it's 18. Episode 18 or 19, but I'm pretty sure it's 18. Delinquent Chronicles, we're back. I'm L.
I'm Neil.
And I'm Joe.
Oh, not Jose?
Twice in a row.
Doesn't matter.
That's Joe. And yeah, welcome back. Thanks for joining us. We're just here today. We're going to shoot to the shit. We're going to try to keep it to a tight hour. Yeah, we're just going to entertain you for a little bit, if you're up for it. And hopefully you guys will be... entertained. We are recording, right?
Yep.
Yeah, not press that button.
Because there's a light change, I was just monitoring it.
Oh yeah, he's just checking to make sure that we look pretty for you in this episode. So we were just talking about some movies earlier. I actually have something, I've not mentioned it to you guys today, but I've got a task for you two.
Right.
Okay. Next episode.
Now?
No. Next episode, okay. Because what I did, I decided that I wanted to round up the best bad guys, my list of best bad guys in movies.
Right.
And I just wanted to list them out and discuss.
Okay.
Okay. Stuff that I like, movies and TV
that
I think are sort of the best bad guys. I did a top 10 and I did some honorable mentions.
Okay, cool.
The honorable mentions is longer than the top 10.
Always the way.
Because it's hard. But
always the way.
Before we do that, so my task to you guys was, is I did best bad guy. I want from Joe, because Joe gets away with not doing a lot of shit for this podcast sometimes. And what I mean by that is, like, I make him do the tasks, but you don't do the tasks. You don't come with lists or nothing like that. So I'm going to make you do it now, Joe, because I love you. But I want to hear your opinion. I want your opinion on the top 10 best, supporting character. What I mean by that is the best supporting character, but I mean like I gotta say
like
the best magical Negro, yeah? So like if you think about it, like who's the best, like Lawrence Fishburne, do you know what I mean, kind of type characters?
So Lawrence Fishburne in The Matrix is your magic.
Mr. Miyagi.
Yeah.
Yeah? Like those kind of like they're the supporting character to the main character.
Mm-hmm.
And they help you get from...
Like Whistler and Blade.
Yeah. Like he's like a magical...
He's a magical cracker.
Yeah, that's right. So your task, if you choose to accept it, is just create a list of your favorite top 10 guys for the next episode.
Okay.
Can you do that?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. That's
so you got two weeks, because we're not filming for another 2 weeks.
That's a difficult prospect.
I know, that's why I gave it to you.
Okay, all right.
Because I never make you do homework. I make him do the homework. That's your turn now.
Okay.
All right, so that's what it was. But hey, before we start, anyone want to round up on some events this week? How's it gone on? Taylor Swift was in Wembley. You know about that, Joe?
Yeah, I do, yeah.
Taylor Swift was in Wembley. What else?
I feel like she's overrated.
Yeah, she... dude, you know what? Gun to my head, right? If I had to name three Taylor Swift songs, I couldn't do it.
I can name one.
I can name one, but if you put a gun to my head and were like, name three Taylor Swift songs.
No.
Same, yeah, I got the inspiration from that because I saw a meme that said like, If someone had a gun to your head, could you name three?
No, I would die.
Could you name three Joe Budden songs?
Yes. Please.
I can't. One song, and it's like, I can name three. Pump, 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 pump it up. Those are the three songs I know.
No, I can name a lot of Joe Budden songs.
Yeah, see, I couldn't. That's why, because I always wonder, like, why does he talk so much smack on other people so much?
You shouldn't have been talking shit.
Oh, I mean, look, if we're going bar for bar, Joe Budden is better than a lot of other rappers. Joe Budden would easily make, he should, if we're talking just line for line, he should make the top 50 best rappers.
Really?
All time.
Huh.
Get the fuck out of here. No, I cannot. It's serious.
Because I can't remember, it might have been Rolling Stone. They released their list of like top 50 rappers of all time. And I looked at that list, and I think I immediately like took a screenshot of it, and I took out the rappers who were like, this motherfucker needs to go, and like put the people who should be in that list in there, and Joe Budden definitely made that list.
Huh, surprising.
Yeah. He's a pain in the ass, but lyrically he is phenomenal.
What about porn stuff?
What, top 50?
Top 50 is a lot, dude. I know, like, maybe... I know all the porn stars...
Well, that's the thing, is, like, all the porn stars that I could really think of, they're from a set generation of
time. Right. Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Like, all the porn stars that I would think of would be now, would be, like, MILF category or up.
Huh. Is Adriana Chechik MILF category?
Adriana Chechik.
Yeah, she is. Yeah, because she's... The moment you aged over 28, that's 24 even, you're in the male category.
Ah.
But I only like, yeah, because I'm like, I think of like, there's, when I think about it, there's porn stars that I know of who are like our age, and they are like, you see, if you ever see them, they're in like, oh, it's the stepmom porn or whatever.
I saw Adriana Chechik do triple anal once. Triple anal.
That's good.
That, you know what? Yeah, that runs back to what we said. You know, it was like, this is your eyes, or this, these are your eyes, and these are your eyes on drugs, and this is your asshole, and this is your asshole in jail. Yeah.
Oof. I mean, you know what? I like Chechik because I've seen her in some YouTube interviews, and she comes across fairly like normal, like a, not that,
you know, she's not normal. She's not normal.
But she's funny. I like her.
I can't remember
what it is. Adriana Chechik.
Yeah.
Google it. Bring it before you have a mobile phone. You're asking a guy who's wearing two masks to Google it for you. A motherfucker has a phone right next to him.
Right.
Just remember, though, that there's a reason why my iPad isn't close to my mic.
Yeah, that's why I'm holding it the way I am. What's her name? Okay.
Adriana Chechik. Guys, she's actually she's a squirter. She squirts from anal, which is...
Oh, right. They put the tube down it.
Adriana, so Adriana, and then Chechik. Just type in C-H-E, I think, and then it will come up.
Okay, yeah, I see her.
She's got a lot of teeth. She has like her teeth, she looks like she reminds me of Tiger Woods with all the fucking teeth in her mouth.
Right, yeah, and like buy an apple for a white picket fence.
Chechik.
Yeah, right. I see her, what she looks like now.
Yeah, she's hot though. She's hot. She takes cream. I saw her take a cream pie from this guy with a massive black dick.
That's a lot.
And
I know who that is.
No, it wasn't Doom or anything. It was just one of those... ever seen them Black Rod videos?
Yeah.
Those are fucking awesome.
They can be. They're a bit overproduced, but then...
They're also a bit racist, but yeah.
I mean...
Porn is racist.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did hear that. I heard that, you know, in porn...
Yeah, the moment...
A woman does a scene with a black guy
their value goes down.
Yeah, but you see that the industry's changed now.
Because, yeah, it has. There's so many black guys doing it.
Then it was like, if you've ever been with if a guy had ever done gay porn, he can't go back to doing straight porn.
Right.
But then like Adriana Chechik is famous for... She's one of the first porn stars to fuck a trans person. Mm.
Oh yeah.
She fucked a tranny and then went back to normal porn and no one cared.
Yeah, because it's Andrea and Cheshire.
Yeah.
She's like, she's the Taylor Swift. Actually, no.
Be real careful with the next sentence you pull out.
She's the Taylor Swift of porn.
Dude, have you, speaking of porn stars, have you seen what fucking, what's her name looks like? She was married to Jenna Jameson. That's it. You see what she looks like now?
No.
Oof. She looks like you took a car that was made for riding on the road, like a sedan.
Oh wait,
took
it off-roading. She married to was, one of the Wahlbergs, Danny Wahlberg?
No. That's Jenny McCarthy.
Ah, yes.
Jenna Jameson was married to
Dennis Rodman.
No. Jenna Jameson was married to Thiago Diego. Was fucking. He's an MMA fighter back in the day with
Thiago Silva.
No.
He's a footballer.
Who was the guy who would fight? He was like the Huntington Beach bad boy. Someone tell me his name.
I mean, I think of Huntington Beach, and I, for some reason, I think Colby Covington.
No. Huntington Beach bad boy. He was.
Brad Armstrong.
Huh?
Brad Armstrong.
No. Old school UFC. He used to fight with Chuck Liddell.
This guy comes up.
No. Type in Jenna Jameson's husband.
Yeah, and that's what it came up with.
Type in Jenna Jameson's ex-husband UFC.
Okay.
It's gonna. You know what? You'll hear the name. I'll hear the name, and we'll feel so fucking stupid that we didn't just name it off rip.
Again, it's come up with these
who's
two people.
Who's the brother who thing fought? Brock Lesnar fought.
No. He didn't fight him.
It says Jay Grinder.
Let me look. Alright.
Type in Jenna Jameson porn star ex-husband.
Jenna.
See if we can find it. We're going to find it. But yeah, she looks like you took a car that was made for driving on the road and took it off-roading. Like the after effects of that.
Alright.
I mean, so for some of these porn stars, they...
Oh, Ortiz.
Thank you.
Tito Ortiz.
Dude, what are you using to Google? Bing? Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Tito Ortiz. Fuck, I feel so stupid for not knowing that off rip.
I think things could be better than Google.
Motherfuckers using DuckDuckGo.
DuckDuckGo's better than Google. DuckDuckGo's better than Google.
Dude, I'm gonna tell you a story afterwards. Remind me of that DuckDuckGo thing. I'll tell you a story, but I can't say it on here. Mm. But yeah. Do you know what I am gonna fucking say? So check this out, yeah? Mm. Tell me what you think of this. I have a friend. I'm not gonna name no names. And he'll probably watch this podcast and be upset about this, yeah? But I've got a friend.
Do we know this person?
No, you don't know him. All right? But, sorry, Joe's just dealing with our lighting issues. Mm. But apologies. I've got a friend, yeah? Mm-hmm. And he... Look, you guys know me. I'm okay with money, right?
Yeah.
So he doesn't have a lot of money, and he was telling me he was very upset about him wanting to borrow some money off like his dad, and his dad only he asked for like £1,000, and his dad like asked him like, how much is it? How much is it you want?
Mm-hmm.
And then he told his dad what it was,
mm-hmm.
and then his dad said, he said, okay, fine, it's £1,000. I need £1,000. He goes, okay, fine. Now I know the number, right?
Mm-hmm.
And his dad lives in another country.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was like, okay, I'm waiting for my dad to give me this money, right? Now, for purposes, just to keep things like clear, just so we know, so my friend, he doesn't work, right, at the moment. He has had a job, he doesn't work at the moment, you know, just through circumstances in life and stuff. He doesn't have a job and hasn't had a job for a while. He's got a bit of habit of borrowing money off people, but and giving it back, you know. But he's got a bit of habit of borrowing money off people quite often. I did ask him, right? So he's not a bad guy. He's a really good guy, lovely guy. But this situation kind of brought up like a bit of a conundrum in me, because I said to him, I was like, "How much do you?" And he was upset because his dad only ended up giving him £700.
Right.
And I was like, "Right."
It's a lot of money.
He is a lot of money, dude. And he was upset because his dad asked him what the amount was and they didn't end up giving it to him, and then said to him, listen, I think you, let's say, for argument's name, his name is Stephen, right? So he said, Stephen, I think you think that I'm like a bank, yeah? But I'm not a bank, I'm your dad, right? And you need to like understand that. And then he was like, yeah, then why did you ask me how much I wanted to borrow, X, Y, Z, whatever. So me and Steven are talking, and then Steven says to me, you know, what do you think about it? And I said, well, I don't think you think about your dad's situation, right? And what his situation is, and maybe he's got bills to pay and X, Y, Z. So then I said to him, I asked him, like, you receive money from, like, from the what's it called now? Universal Credit, I guess?
Right? Oh, yeah.
So you say, how much do you get? And he's like, £300 a, and I was like, £300 every 2 weeks? Or, and he's like, £300 a month. And I was like, a month? Fuck, dude. How do you live on that, right? But then, like, he lives at his grandfather's house.
Okay.
And I'm assuming... I don't know the ins and outs of that, but I did ask. And then he has children, and
Jesus.
And but they don't live with him. Two baby mothers, which whatever. No one's here to judge.
Sky Black.
Yeah.
Sky Black.
No.
Okay.
His dad gave him £700. What kind of question is that?
What do you mean by that?
What do you mean by that? Huh? Most black fathers. What do you mean by that? Most black fathers are not just handing out £700.
Well, I asked him. His father wasn't really present within his formative years.
Yeah, but even
so, I was like, do you feel that you're entitled to that money? Do you feel like you're entitled to the fact
because
that
he wasn't there? So
like,
you feel
and then, but you know, listen, I just want to preface this with my friend Steven is a really good guy, right? Yeah. And he's an honourable guy. He's not a bad guy, but I just feel like I don't know. I feel like he's in a bit of a rut, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he's probably going to be really upset that I talked about this, but I'm like, he'll know who he is. His name isn't Steven, it's not even close to Steven. He'll know who he is, though.
I think what it is he'll be upset because he'll know we're talking about him, but we don't know who he is.
Yeah.
And none of the audience
knows who he is. Nobody knows who he is.
So whilst he might be upset, it's like, okay, you're upset that we're talking about your situation. But nobody knows you, including two of the three people talking, don't know who you are.
But then I also wanted to run it by you guys to see where you stand on this, because I care about you, dude, and your opinion is really valid, and I just wanted to see what you think about what the situation is. So, long story short, we're talking. I said, okay, you should get £300 from the government, X, Y, Z, right? How do you spend that money? So he goes out in town in central London. He goes... goes out drinking sometimes every like Thursday or every other Thursday when he can afford it to go do like karaoke, and he enjoys that. But my biggest gripe is that he smokes a lot, right? Now, I used to be a smoker. I was a smoker for many years since I was like 14 years old, and I stopped smoking.
A lot of money.
Yeah, it's really expensive now.
Tobacco's
right?
expensive.
Yeah. He smokes roll-ups, right? So he...
less expensive, but still expensive.
But yeah, still disgusting. Right? So I stopped smoking years ago, like before my son was born, stopped smoking. And then I stopped even vaping a bunch of years ago as well, right? So I don't even do any of that. I don't take any tobacco in any capacity. So then I said to him, I was like, you spend that much money on cigarettes, right? He was like, yeah, it's like £100. How much? £100. So one third of what he earns.
Goes on.
Is given by the government.
Yeah.
He spends on cigarettes, right?
That's a lot of tobacco.
It's a lot of tobacco, right? But then you think like, if you've got nothing to do all day, apart from like, you know, just smoking a lot.
Motherfucker, do some press ups.
Hold on. Right. So check this out, right? So I said to him, I was like, I'll tell you what I'm going to do for you, right? Because we had an incident once where he borrowed some money off me. He never paid it back. And then I told him, but he said he was going to pay it back on a specific time frame, and I held him to it, and then he didn't give it to me.
You said you're going to rip his balls with your away from his coat with your bare
hands. I said, like, I'm never going to lend you money again because we had like a disagreement about it, and then he said he had it after I called him and asked him for it, and then he was like, it's here in cash. And as you guys know me, I don't carry cash at all. So I was just like, you want me to come and collect my money that I had to chase you for, dude? I was like, the respectful thing would be...
to bring it to you.
Yeah.
Or give it back to me in the manner of which I gave it to you, right?
Yeah.
So there was like a lesson learned. But we squashed that. We had a discussion. Like I said, he feels bad about it. He didn't understand. I explained it to him.
Mm.
You know, he's good now. We're good, right?
He's a little slow, but he got it.
But he knows that I'm never going to
lend him any
money again, right? So obviously there's a money situation there between him and his family members. Either way, so I said to him, here's what I'm going to do for you, man. I'm going, how much do you spend? He went, £100 a month, basically, right? I said, okay, if you stop smoking right now, right? And save £100 every month till August, I will match what you save. So I will double your money, right? Mm-hmm. To teach you how to budget whatever you're receiving, but to also help you stop smoking, mm-hmm. right? I will double your money in your account. It's free money. You don't have to do anything but just stop smoking. Mm-hmm. And then I'll teach you how to budget what you've got left for your expenditures, right? If you can prove to me that you legitimately stop smoking and stop buying cigarettes, he paused for a second and he was like, He goes, no, I need to smoke because it helps me get through it. And then I got mad because he was like, you know, when I was going through the whole bullshit with my ex-girlfriend, like cigarettes are there. And I got mad at him because I was like, you're attributing you getting through it to a plant. You know what I mean? Like, you're giving the credit to tobacco. But the credit is yours, my dude, because you did that. And I'm trying to give him his props, right?
Right, right.
So then he then says, so I start to push it. I said, okay, I'll tell you what, my dude. He goes, oh, you know what? I ever have to go to like therapy, cigarettes, or like gym. I said, I'll tell you what, if you save those two months, those £200, not only will I match your money, but I will pay for your gym membership for a year upfront. So I'll cover his gym membership. I said, how much is it a month? 38. And I said, okay, let's just say £380, whatever. I'll give £380 plus the 200. So I'll pay for your gym membership and the 200. He's still, I'm an RA. And he goes, all right, cool, I'll do it. I said, okay. I said, have you got any tobacco right now? He went, yeah. And I said, I just bought a bag yesterday. I said, throw that away. No, I can't throw it away. I'm throwing money away. And I said,
how much did you spend?
I said, hold on. I said, how much did you spend? He went, I spent £18. And I said, I'll pay you the £18 right now to throw it away. I'll make you whole right now, financially. And he's still, I'm in an iron about it. And I said, and he's like, no, I can't do that. I'm not just going to throw that away. And I said, just tip it out. I'll come around to your house now. I'll pick it up. I'll give you the cash, however you want it. Tip it out. I'll tip it out right now. We're good to go. He was like, no, I can't do it. And I said, so I even upped the ante. I said, final offer. Right now. I'll give you £100 right now. Plus the £18 that it costs you for the tobacco. Plus I'll match your £200 that you save. And I'll still pay for the gym membership. What do you think he said?
No.
Yeah, I'll do it.
No.
He said yeah.
I reckon he said no.
He said no.
Because the thing is, I'll tell you why. I think this is a human problem, not just a this person problem. Is people don't think long term.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I said to him.
Yeah.
I told him about the study that they did with children where they gave them like a cookie. Mm-hmm. And they said, if you don't eat this cookie, in 5 minutes, we'll come back and give you another cookie.
Mm-hmm.
But if you eat it now, you don't get any more cookies. And they all ate the cookie.
Yeah, people can't. I think people are stuck in that. I think it's partly to do with, obviously, it's part of the food that we eat. We're going to go too much into all this stuff, right? But the food that we eat, like especially if you eat fast food, McDonald's and all that shit.
Yeah, it's a cycle of chemicals
and allergens and things in it, right? That make you want something, you want it now. And the idea of I can wait and have this later is foreign, right? But I also think that there is a difference. I used to say there's a difference between I want and I would like.
Mm-hmm.
I said, when you would like something, so if somebody says to you, I would like to go to America on holiday. I'd like to go to America. I said, okay, cool. It costs $500 for the flight and it will cost $400 for the hotel. So it's costing $900 to get there and stay there.
Mm-hmm.
And you just need to figure out whatever spending money you need, whatever you're going to do whilst you're out there. So you figure a ballpark figure, let's say $1,500, gets you there, has you stay in there, and has you, you know, food, transportation, whatever you need whilst you're there, $1,500.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, okay, so if you save £100 a month, in 15 months, you're good to go.
Mm-hmm.
But if you would like to, you're not saving that £100 a month for them 15 months. If you're like, I want to go, When you say I want to go to America, it takes you less than 15 months to get it.
Yes, but yeah.
Because you're saving, you're like, my baseline is going to be £100 a month. But then when you're like, okay, so baseline is £100 a month. And then you're like, ooh, I could spend £20 on this Blu-ray. That's still going to be able to be, that's still going to be available when I come back from holiday. And you're like, I won't spend that 20. I'm going to hold on to that. That's going to go into the pot.
And that's all I'm asking him to do, bro.
Right. Yeah.
Just hold that money.
But admittedly, tobacco is highly addictive. Not everybody has the same level of mental strength and fortitude.
He also said that. He said, you're better than me, L, because I can't do it. I'm a piece of shit. And I said, I'm not better than you. Because I just stopped, right? Because I can't just stop. And I was like, I know, but you can. Trust me, you can.
Well, this
if somebody put a gun to your head, you would do it.
Yeah.
So why can't you do it now? It's the same thing. You're still going to die. You're just prolonging the process.
Yeah. Because I think of it, how I look at it is, when people are like, oh, I can't just stop, I was like, yeah, you can. Because if, say, we'll use smoking as the example. Say, oh, you're a smoker, you're always buying tobacco and blah, 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 right? So, okay, yeah, and I'm, because I can see this forest evergreen with everything behind you, Joe, right? Here's what I'll say. If somebody,
it's a screensaver for Apple TV, by the way.
Yeah. If somebody dropped you there, and you know there is not
a shop,
there's not a shop, there's not a tobacco shop,
processing plant
for, let's say, 2,000 miles.
You're going to figure it out.
You ain't smoking, right? You'll be done with smoking. Just like, I'm same way when people are like, I can't give up alcohol, or I can't give up drugs, or I can't give up whatever it is that you feel you can't give up, you can give it up. I was like, are you willing to put yourself in a position that you'd be forced into to give it up? It's like, oh, you can't give up going to McDonald's. Go somewhere where there's no McDonald's. Right? Or avoid putting yourself in a position where you have to go to a McDonald's or go into a McDonald's. It's people aren't willing to force themselves into a position that takes them away from something.
I'll add one thing to that. When I used to see my psychiatrist, she gave me a trick to try to give up something or change my mental thought pattern.
Yeah.
And that's, okay, you like doing this thing. Let's say you do it 4 times a week, then do it 3 times a week, then do it twice, then do it once, and then before long, you'll start to, your mind starts to shift and needing that thing, depending on what it is. But it helped me in many different ways. Okay, I need to do this. My mind is doing this, so without, like, stopping cold turkey, just okay, think of it in increments, and then bring it down to the most minimum you can, and then get rid of it, or try to get rid of it. But yeah, anyway, that's my two cents on it.
For me, I look at it like this, right? When there are times when I'm like, I need to give something up, right? Or not even need to. Sometimes it's just, I want to give something up. If I'm like, okay, I'm going to give it up. Now, this works for me. It doesn't work for everybody, so I don't recommend it. Is I'll just have like a blowout session on it.
Oh, right.
So it'd be like, if I'm like, okay, I'm going to stop eating McDonald's, then I'm like, I will go to McDonald's, I will buy everything that I want from McDonald's that day. So it'd be like, I want a double quarter pounder, triple cheeseburger, 2 apple pies, chips. I'll order the mother load.
Right.
And eat it all. And then when I'm done, I'm done. Right? And now I know every time I think about it and think about how good it is, I can at least remind myself, yeah, I had that one big blowout, so I'm good.
It's how I feel about Southern Comfort.
Ah, you gave it up.
I didn't give it up. I just will never ever drink that again because I almost died on it. Like, not specifically died, but I just remember I was talking about this with a friend the other night who was around my house when I was younger. He came around, I had a free house, and he brought around some Southern Comfort and Absolute Vodka. Not in the same bottle, obviously, but he just brought it around and we got shit-faced. and I drank so much Summer Puppet, and I will never ever be able to get that fucking mentality, that the taste. Thought of that coming out of me through my mouth ever again. Because I was throwing up so much. It was the worst, and I hate that drink.
that's happened to me with a few. That's when I found my limit in drinking alcohol. Yeah. So, oh, this is my limit. The moment I throw up, okay, I've got this under control. I don't drink that often, yes. And when I do drink, I know, okay, I've got to this point.
You know where your limit is, yeah.
I'm good. And it's almost like throwing up is like your, all right, that's enough out of you, buddy. that's your line. And
well, yeah, because I mean, look, I don't know how you guys look at your bodies internally. I look at my body internally.
Actually,
like, no, I don't. I'm like. I look at it like my body is a construction system, and there are construction workers in there, and then, you know, it's like when you're like, oh, whatever it is, like you've eaten something and like it's made you feel sick. Maybe you had some bad seafood or something, right? And you're like, oh man, I think I'm gonna be sick. That's just like, hey, boss, we got a problem with the pipes, you know.
Mine's like a fun fair.
Anatomy Park, like
an amusement park.
Is that what it is? Anatomy Park.
Yeah.
Anatomy Park. Yeah.
But it's like, if you, I think it's easy to do something up.
Yeah.
If you've got the right reason, because
well, so it's easy to do something up, right? But I said that I always speak to other people about stuff like this for some perspective to find out whether or not I may have overreacted in something.
No.
But I didn't actually overreact to him. I did tell him I was disappointed. No,
you gave him options.
I was like, man, I'm disappointed, but I'm not angry.
Yeah.
And he was like, I'm a piece of shit. I like smoking. I said, that's more fun. Oh, that's cool.
That's
like,
more him than you.
Yeah, but that's been...
But he's not a bad guy. Yeah. I want to preface this, but he's not a bad person. He's a good guy, yeah?
Right.
I did ask another friend of mine the same thing. He went, fucking people are so lazy. And I mean, he's not lazy. He goes, yeah, they'll do any. He's like, you gave him every opportunity. Every time he gave an excuse, you counteracted it.
Yeah.
And he still said no. He goes, then that means he just doesn't want it.
That's right.
As much as he says he does. Yeah. And I was like, oh, I guess that's a good point. I don't know. Do you know? It's just a weird one.
But also, I would say there is a thing of sometimes people just want to present you with their situation. Not for you to feel sorry for them or for them to feel sorry about for themselves.
Just to acknowledge.
But they just acknowledge that, oh, this is the thing I'm in. And they just kind of just want someone to be like, oh, that sucks, man. I'm sorry to hear that.
Nah, he directly asked me for my candor. He was like, I want your advice. I want your candid advice. I appreciate you tell me what you think in the situation. And I gave it to him. And I said, you know, and I did say to him, I was like, you know, there are some things about your situation that are definitely self-imposed.
Mm-hmm.
And I said it to it not like that. I said it to him in the very L way that I say things.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm telling you this like this because I don't want you to think I don't care about you. Mm-hmm. Like, but I want you need to hear it. You know. But yeah, man, it kind of hurt me to see that whole situation. I was kind of fucked up about it because I was like, I'm willing to put myself on the line financially to help you, so that to get you out of this rut. You know. Mm-hmm. And still, fucking, you said no. It's just a disappointment.
Really. I mean, maybe he has to get to a point where things. Cause I know this with some of the things that in my life, I've had to get to a point where
it gets so bad.
Yeah, it's either like, this or that.
Yeah,
and it gets so bad that you have to reevaluate yourself. Mm-hmm. And
you need to hit the basement of rock bottom.
Yeah.
And then you're like, okay.
Yeah,
I'm done. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. I guess, you need to have some good discovery of yourself. As long as you are really self-aware, which is a very difficult thing to do, because it's difficult to look at yourself, look at a situation that involved you, and be like, I was the asshole in the situation.
Am I so out of touch? No, it's the children who are wrong.
Right. It's not easy because there's always you always have your internal excuses for why you did something, how you did something, why you wouldn't do something, why, oh, somebody offered you this amount of money to do something and you said no, why? And you're like, I have my excuse because I know what I feel like, or what, you know, how bad the headache is if I don't smoke, or I know how bad my stomach feels if I don't eat this thing, I know how bad this is if I don't, you know, you think of the first hurdle, not thinking, once you've got over that hurdle, you don't have to go back over it.
Hmm.
So
thinking of climbing up, not climbing down.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, I don't know. I just wanted to share that little anecdote that happened to me this week, where I was just like, it's kind of a situation when you deal with somebody, and you're like, I wish he had really taken me up on it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I would have made sure that I would have compensated him, you know, accordingly, because he would have done. I think he would have done it.
Mm-hmm.
But it, for me, it was like, I take it or leave it now.
Yeah.
Like, because I'm having a gracious moment in my mind. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm like, okay, I got a bit of extra money here. All right, we can do it.
Mm-hmm.
Let's
mm-hmm.
do it. But then he just.
And I know that feeling. When I started making a bit of money, I wanted to help. I was like, okay, I have the ability to help my mum now, and I can help other people if they need to. And I like, if I ever have money again, that's what I would like to do as well. If someone needs help, I would like to talk him through it and say, look, I can help you with this, or. I don't know, I think that's the most noblest thing you can do if you have.
If I won the lottery and I could do it and I had enough spare, I'd pay off your mortgage for you, Neil.
Thank you.
I want you to know that.
Thank you.
This is a big change from the past weeks of.
We're going to get some coochie soon enough.
What do you mean, what's the coochie, bro?
No, because obviously, like, we're having a fairly lovely, civil conversation where we're talking about something somewhat serious. You know, we're not talking about, like, you know, having sex.
We've gone woke.
Oh, yeah, from pee hole fucking.
Yeah. We've gone woke.
So hold on. So speaking of shit, this guy had mug shorty to show me today. You want to put that up on the screen first?
Mug shot.
It's literally mug shorty. Just one. One sole mug shorty.
Is it mine?
No.
Joe, we love you, but you, sir, would not be a mugshot. In Eastern Europe, you'd be a definite mugshot. You'd be the tastiest mud chocolate ever seen.
Yeah.
He dies.
Now, obviously, we know your feelings towards individuals of this
Oh my God, hold on. So, earlier, before we started the podcast, we were watching the video for Boa by Meg Thee Stallion, and in that music video, Meg Thee Stallion is looking
lovely. Mwah,
she's looking hot, dude, and I was like, I would ruin that. He concurs.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking Joe over here, he went, nah, and I went, why? And he goes, I shit you not, he goes, he like, did you catch that? You must have missed it. Let me do that again. He went like this on his arm, and he went, nope. Because of the colour of her skin, I want to just confirm, Joey's a black man. That's his dad. Joey's a black man. And I was just like, oh, don't act like you're not going to use that three fucking times this week.
Uncle Ruckus, boy.
Uncle Ruckus right here.
Don't trust them new niggas over there. Leaving they nigga essence in the air.
Fucking hell. But yeah, anyway, go ahead.
I have no shame in that.
fair news.
No shame in that. Black women have been very easy to tell me that I'm a piece of shit, so.
Okay, go ahead. All right, talk to us about this picture.
Right, so we're looking at this individual, right? Now, because this is a very different one, it's
to confirm, sorry, do you want to tell people what Mug Shorties is, and also apparently remind Joe because he's forgotten?
Right, so Mug Shorties is a page on Instagram, and I'm sure it's in other places as well, where you will find the mugshots of some very attractive young women, right? Or depending on your preferences, attractive young women. Right? And you'll usually find their mugshot and what they have done. Person that the three of us are looking at, they technically, this was not on Mug Shorties, it was just a mugshot that came up, and we'll get into why it came up. So that person, right? And so that's the individual who a number of people, when I saw this, because it wasn't on Mug Shorties, and when I saw this, I was like, oh, why is that not on Mug Shorties? And it was like, people were talking about this person and the things that they would do to this person. Now, what they would sexually do to this person. Now, I would like to know, firstly, we'll keep it like traditional Mug Shorties, our segment. What do you think this person did?
Arm robbery.
All right, so we've got arm robbery and Joseph.
I because she looks borderline evil. The eyes do it for me. She's just like, she's got the eyes of a lion. the nose of a lion.
To quote you from episode 9, the darker the shade, the less clear it is.
She's got that shade where she's confused mentally.
What, because she's mixed race?
Yeah. Yeah. She's confused. So, she either murdered a few people or, yeah, it's probably murder. Is she American?
Huh?
American. Yeah, murder.
All right, so we got armed robbery and murder. Right. Well, this person hit and run and fleeing the scene. Now,
look at the name.
If you look at the name,
Jaquavius Johnson.
Because that is not a female.
That's a whole last man.
That's
right
a whole dude.
But I'm looking at a damn man.
Yeah, I thought as
man
much.
Man right there, man.
Thought as much.
It is not sir, it is ma'am.
Excuse me, it's ma'am. It is ma'am.
Yeah. I was just like...
But you can't say that anymore. She's a, she is a person that, does, that wants that... what did they call it? Say... something is a or whatever, yeah.
But yeah, I saw
she is
that.
As they used to call them, a she
Transformers.
A female.
Okay.
Yeah, transform. Mandem in disguise.
Mandem in disguise.
That is beautiful.
That's not me, bro. That was Skepta.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's get that song. Yeah. Transformers. Mandem in disguise.
That is nice. I like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, so.
Some change.
Saw that.
I mean, yeah, again, it's, if it's, it's either the, I shouldn't talk bad about the Filipinos, but,
nah, because they work in our hospitals, man.
I mean, the way you said, I can't talk about the Filipinos, I mean, you already prefaced that, it's just like, the, it's like,
I mean, people call us the blacks.
This is true.
Yeah. But you call them the blacks too, bro.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm as being part of as my mum was partially tanned. I can't go full racist on that. But
what's our time check, by the way?
You have another 20 minutes.
Oh, all right, cool.
I got a couple of things.
You got a couple of things. Go ahead. I want to finish it with this.
All right, cool. Because But no, because I interrupted you.
I was just going to say. Look, there's people in my family that I clearly don't like but and do like. But if my cousins are dark skinned, I like them enough. But when it comes to,
I got family members that I don't like. Wait, nothing to do with their skin color.
Right. Imagine him going to the cookout and be like, "I'm gonna walk in the moonlight with you." I'm gonna hold my hand.
Okay, what's it?
D'Artagnan, motherfucker.
Was it 100 black coffins?
Is it? I got 100 black coffins for 100 black men.
I'm not
that's like Rick Ross too. Yeah, yeah, that's from, a bad boy Django. Film, I love Django, dude. I fucking love that movie.
Django Rechained.
Unchained.
Well, for you,
he'd be Rechained. Yeah. He'd be like, yeah. He'd be Steven in that one. Who that nigga up on that nag? Who this nigga on that nag?
Punani.
I can just imagine him just being like, Jaquavius Johnson. It was like, anybody know how these nigga names come about?
You never know how these nigga nicknames get started.
Sequely.
You're fucking Candy. What's his name?
Calvin Candy.
Calvin Candy, bro. That is you, bro.
Calvin Candy?
Yeah. Leonardo DiCaprio.
Oh, no. No, he's actually racist.
We're having white cake. The way he says it.
Exceptional.
Yeah.
But right. if my defense,
here we go. Mississippi burning right here. Let's go.
Oh, damn right, Mississippi burning.
oh my god.
If I was to montage what happened to me through school up until college, you would feel the exact same way I would.
I'm going to montage all your racist comments into one, like,
do it and show my face.
I'll tell you like this, right?
Put my face on it, please.
I'll tell you like this, wrong finger, right? I reckon you and I had a very similar experience.
Right.
Going through school, right? I didn't really have it in primary school, but secondary school, yeah, like, there was some comments. There was a lot of shit that went through. But I think maybe, because obviously I don't know exactly what happened, so I'm like, I reckon you probably had it worse than I did.
Well. You Negroes gonna play basketball or what?
Yeah, you Negroes. What's the matter? Did you realize you didn't belong in a white man's game, you Negroes?
That's right, this isn't a game for Negroes. Mm-mm. It's a game for good, honest, white people. Mm-hmm. Not for Negroes. You understand? Negroes!
White knights!
White knights!
White
knights!
White knights!
White knights!
I mean, yeah.
But it was like, it's just a thing of, I look at it, I just think, kids in general, all races, kids are pricks.
Sorry.
Yeah, right? They are.
I'm sorry, if you're watching this and you're between the ages of like 12
and 19. You shouldn't be watching this, firstly.
I mean, firstly, you shouldn't be watching it, but if you are watching it, you're proving my point, because you're probably a little bit of a prick.
Fuck them kids.
Right? Then again, if you're watching us, you can understand what being a prick can be like, right? In some of our tales, some of the times that we went as nice as we should have been.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I've got massive regrets for being a prick when I was a kid.
Yeah, but that's the thing. I think kids in general are pricks. You don't know any better. I had
to lick my ass. That was great.
But, you know, it's like sometimes you know, because kids can be pricks because they don't know too much better, is the thing of, I just literally was like, yeah, they said a bunch of shit, but they were kids and they were looking for the cracks in the armor to dig at, and that was a crack in the armor that they dug at.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, now I'm an adult and I'm like, when I think of all the people who said horrible things to me in school, relating to like, you don't act black, you don't act like a black guy, why do you listen to that music, why are you watching this show, why aren't you watching this, why aren't you doing that, all of these things, there I look at them and I just think, for the most part, the people who would ask me those questions and say those things, I'm like, y'all ain't doing too good in life right now. Right? some of them ain't doing too good in life.
Yeah.
There are some who are doing exceptionally well in life.
Mm-hmm.
I say cool. But the ones who are doing too well in life, I was like, maybe if you were a little concerned about something other than how black I was.
Mm-hmm. Stop letting the wrong guys come in you.
You know, like, maybe if you were concerned something other than how black you thought I was, you'd be comfortable.
You'd
be a little different.
Yeah.
Maybe you're more like Joe and worried about the colour of the skin of the guy you're letting come inside you.
Yeah, exactly. If you're more like me, you'd be a better person. Just remember that.
When you said that, I literally had a flash in my mind of the image of a person, and I was just like, but yeah.
Hey man, as I said, I used to hold back on my malice towards black women, but no more.
Well, you know what it is?
Don't even look at them straight in the eye.
Who is this person who speaks to me as though I needed his advice?
Reaching an age where it's like we're old enough to be like,
yeah, I don't give a fuck.
I've reached the age where now I can genuinely say I don't give a fuck.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck.
Fair enough.
Don't give a fuck.
Yeah. And do things and people can be like, that's not nice, and you can just look at them like Skeletor, I'm not nice.
yeah. I don't give a fuck about what you're saying to me or who you are. Disappear from my sight.
I have contained my rage for as long as possible, but I shall unleash my fury upon you like the crashing of a thousand waves! Begone, vile man! Begone from me!
Begone!
I love that. The whitest thing, bro.
I had to do it. I had to. I couldn't. I couldn't resist. When I saw your hand closed, I was like,
grab.
But
speaking on this, when we're talking about racism and stuff, right? Have either of you heard of a Japanese music act called Double?
No.
Right. So we were all alive for 90s R&B. Yeah, we were all alive for 90s R&B. Well, there is a Japanese woman. It might be a woman, it might be two women. There's a Japanese woman whose name is Double, who makes 90s R&B. This woman is 50. I've never heard of her until now. She's been making music since the 90s, I think.
Okay.
And some of her songs are dope.
Okay.
Some of, I was like, when
play,
the
we're going to play some after this.
Yeah, we're going to play some after this. But I say, one of her songs started playing it because I heard it on, might have been on Instagram. But I was like scrolling and I saw this guy and he was like, when Japanese R&B comes on. And I was just like, I listened to some music made by people from and living in Japan. I'm like, okay, I might not like it, you know. I've listened to like soundtracks from like anime shows and like Samurai Champloo, one of my favorite soundtracks. So I'm like, some of this music is cool. I'm like, I'm not gonna hear anything like out of the ordinary. And it kicked in and I was like, yo, this could make playlists. This could make playlists that, you know, like you've got Mary J. Blige and you've got, you know, some named artists in there, and this could sit alongside it. I was in shock for that.
It's, and what kind is it?
It's just R&B music. Some of it is in English, some of it is in Japanese, but it's just R&B music.
Because Japan got that really cool like 80s city pop stuff, which I love, by the way, that Maria Takeuchi, Plastic Love kind of shit.
Yeah.
I'm into that, dude. I've gone down a rabbit hole. Like, if you know me, you know I love like Metallica, Machine Head, a lot of heavy metal, a lot of grunge and new metal, but then also there's another side of me that really loves like random Japanese city pop 80s kind of bullshit where I'm just like, yeah, Plastic Love, motherfucker, you know?
Yeah.
Gay, bro. So gay.
But it's not, though.
Yeah, I know, but if you would look at me, you'd be like, this dude?
Oh, wait.
Listen, I had that.
I think I was a bear in a fucking gay club, bro.
Look, I've had that.
I'm here just trolling for cock.
I've had that times coming here, being in my car when the weather's nice, windows down, and I'm just playing music.
Making my way
and
to
my the thing is, the way my, because obviously I just like let the music just shuffle, so I don't know what's coming on next. But there was a time when it was Eminem As the World Turns played, and then it finished, and then it immediately kicked into like Wham. Right? And I was like, you know, there was, and I'm like, you know, like, I'm not singing along, but I'm like, it's clear if you looked in the car and you looked at me, I'm mouthing the words that are coming out of the car, right? And I was like, went from Eminem to Wham to Nas, then it went to Metallica, and I'm like, obviously at each moment in time, I'm at a different position and there's different cars around me. But I reckon there have been moments where people have probably heard music, looked in the car, and been like,
what?
Right?
Dude, on a good day, you could catch me listening. Like, if it's a nice day, fucking weather's out, I'll go from, like, Agoraphobical Nosebleed, song 2, to, like, all I wanna do is have some fun. Just chilling, listening to some Sheryl Crow in the car, bro. Like, it's just strange. Music hits you the way it hits you, man.
Yeah. High five!
You know, fucking.
Yeah, it's mood.
But yeah, what's feeling. This band called? What's this lady called?
They're called Double.
Double. Is it Double. A woman or a group?
I think it's just a woman.
Because
every time I looked it up, it's just been one woman.
Alright, I'm gonna check it out. I wanna see it. Well, after we're done here, we're gonna check it out.
So there was that. And there was another thing I wanted to talk about, because we spoke about TV shows before.
Uh-huh.
One of them was that the magic show what's the guy's name?
Oh, the Carbonara. Paul Daniels.
Carbonara, right? Oh, yeah. And I saw this show, and this thing, I forgot.
Was it his show? No, different show.
It was a different show. I forgot this show existed. And this is how I say it, right? When I say people don't have the internal strength that they used to. Do you guys remember a show called Scare Tactics?
Yeah.
You remember Scare Tactics?
It's just Sky One, right?
I think it was Sky One.
Yeah.
Right? Joe, this show was wild. Right? Okay. The clip that I saw recently that reminded me this show was wild was a guy goes and he pretends to be a genie and he pretends to grant this guy a wish. And the wish is that he can fly.
Okay.
So the guy's like, granted.
I wish I can fly.
Oh, darling. Granted.
So the guy's like, yeah, cool. He's on like the first floor in a house. He runs out the house, jumps out the first story balcony window, and the guy's like, no. He's
granted.
No. Tell him no.
But you know,
I can fly.
No, listen.
Jumps out, and then when the guy looks over the railing, my guy is on the ground, not moving. Blood is leaking out of him.
No.
Oh my!
Is that a real brain?
Tommy!
And they run downstairs, and he's like, "Why did you tell him that he could fly?" All the people are like, "Why did you tell him that?" And they were like, "Look, I tried to stop him. I was paid to tell him that he could grant any wish."
Tommy, come on!
Dude, I got warrants. I'm out.
Can we sell you, Tommy?
No, he's okay.
Why did you tell him he could fly up there?
I tried to tell him not to. I tried to tell him not to, but you stopped me.
And they were like, you think that's funny? And then he was like, huh? He was like, you want to know something else that's funny? And the guy's like, maybe. And it was like,
gotcha.
This is a prank. You're on Scare Tactics.
Right.
You think this is funny?
No, I don't think it's funny.
You want to know what's funny?
Maybe.
You're on Scare Tactics.
Seriously?
Right.
All right. You know what? I would fucking kill somebody if they. I'd kill you, bro. If you did that to me, I'd kill you.
What did he just jump up and he was like, "I can fly"?
It's like that one, like that Darren Brown one that he did, Trick or Treat with the fucking chick in the car crash. Have you ever seen that one?
No, I haven't.
So they're like, this is like a long con, right? So she applied to be on like one Channel 4 TV show.
Yeah.
And then they don't say nothing for ages, and then Darren Brown like rolls up. So basically they fuck with her car. They ask her to drive to a location as part of the show to meet with Darren Brown.
Yeah.
And then like he pulls up on her from out of nowhere, like presses her, bro. And he just goes, okay, I'm Darren Brown, I want you to pick one of these cards and I won't tell you what it is. One says trick, one says truth, right?
Go light.
It's okay, Jules. Stay in the car.
Oh, fucking hell.
So you volunteered to take part in the show?
I did.
We'd love to use you.
Okay.
What happens to you on the show depends on your choice of one of two cards. Now, one of them says trick,
mm-hmm.
and one of them says treat. You're going to go for that one there?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, I don't want you seeing which one you've picked. So I'm going to ask you to face that way for me and close your eyes as well so you don't see a reflection. Turn right round.
Mm-hmm.
Keep your eyes closed.
Yeah. She picks one, it's trick, yeah? You know, Darren Brown's like, yeah. Like, you know, fucking, he's in, right? So he's like, got ya. So they've hidden a camera in her car, yeah? And then like the people who have her friends and stuff, they're also like, yeah, she's just really bad at driving. And she's in the camera, in the car, they got this hidden camera. And like she is or doing her makeup in the car, and she talks on her phone in the car, like all this dumb shit, not paying attention to the road. Darren Brown's like, I've got you, yeah.
At some point in the next 4 weeks, Jules will find out whether she's picked a trick or a treat. The covert camera we installed automatically records her whenever she's in the car. After watching her hands-free approach to driving during the first week's recordings, the idea for her trick began to take shape. Jules is going to have an out-of-body experience and witness her own death in a car crash. To make this possible, we needed a completely convincing double, and the only way to achieve that was to make an exact copy of Jules' face.
So, they tell her, like, unrelated, she wins a spa day, right? But what they really did was they made a mold of her face, innit?
Yeah.
Using the plaster, like Plaster Paris. They tell her she's on a spa, okay, and they do the whole thing, but really the person who's doing the thing is the, taking a mold of her face to make a life, like a Hollywood mask, innit?
Mm.
Of her.
And so we arranged for her to be invited to what was apparently a free spa treatment. She has no idea this has anything to do with us. She took the bait and made her way to our specially created beauty parlor, which we've rigged with hidden cameras. With the help of a Hollywood special effects expert, we embarked on a first in the history of prosthetics.
I don't know of anyone who's done this before, so a fantastic challenge and interesting to life cast somebody without them knowing.
I'm keeping them closed. I'm just going to work over your eyelid now.
Is that necessary?
Yeah, it's a cooling mask.
The beautician is actually our own makeup artist, whose job it is to babble reassuring cosmetic nonsense to Jules and hide the fact that a big hairy American bloke is applying latex and plaster to her face.
Apply over your mouth now. Working around your mouth. It's a little bright in here, so keep your eyes closed for me. And we're going to go bright now.
We've got a great cast, and a fantastic life cast. It will hopefully look as much like our subject as possible. So when she looks at this person, she'll be seeing herself, like looking in a mirror.
Jules has absolutely no idea what is about to happen to her.
And then like time goes by, like so far her time, she's kind of forgotten about being on the show. And then they call her and they say, you need to meet us in this location wearing these clothes.
Jules's trick is about to begin. She received a phone call telling her she was required for a photo shoot for the series. She was told to drive alone and to wear the outfit that she'd been sent.
She's like, okay, cool. So, and then they get a purse, a body double to wear the same clothes as she's wearing. And then they call her and he plays a noise over the phone and she like passes out. She pulls over, it passes out, and then they set up this whole scene where like her feet are like stuck to the ground, and there's like an ambulance, and they got a copy of her car, and it's all crashed, and her dead body is in the car, and then like the police and the ambulance turn up, and there's a guy pretending to be an actor, and he's like, oh my god, like pretending to be part of the accident, oh, I didn't see her.
In the 3 weeks since Jules unknowingly chose a trick card, we've made a deathly mask of her face without her knowledge, which can now be placed on an actress of similar build. We've also cast some actors to play various parts in her unfolding nightmare. They've all been briefed to ignore her. Finally, there is a psychologist standing by should Jules require aftercare. All these elements will now be brought together in a cordoned off section of the Berkshire countryside. All the cameras remain out of sight.
She's standing there, bruv, looking at her body, innit? She's like, be careful with my back. And like everyone's ignoring her. And she can't move, right? Because she would obviously start grabbing people. And so she can't move because her feet are stuck to the ground. Like they've glued her feet to the ground.
So she feels like she's a ghost.
So she's like, oh my God, what's going on? What's happening? And like, she's like, oh my God, can someone tell me what's going on? And everyone's ignoring her. Like it's a crime scene. And they've like policed it off and everything.
Jules is about to wake up fixed to the floor and staring at her own car with her dead self in the driving seat.
Standing by.
God. Are you okay? Hello?
right. Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Talk to me. I'm all right. It's the lights aren't working, so I
the lights weren't working.
And next thing I know, she's gone in to meet him.
Fucking hell! Jesus Christ! Hello, excuse me. Hello. Hello.
How old
are you? Hello.
I'm 25.
Fucking
legs. Yeah. And I
just lift up onto the cot. And you're ready to go.
Mum, we're back.
Two, three.
Oh, Jesus.
And then Darren Brown just rolls in and like makes her go to sleep, and then it just says like at the end, it says she was received like psychiatric counselling.
Wow.
And hopefully she learned her lesson, innit? It stops fucking talking on the phone and driving and shit. Like right. Fuck up,
Jesus God. Christ.
Look, she felt like she was about to meet Jesus.
Yeah, right? Dude, she thought she was dead, innit? Because they treated like everyone just ignored her. She thought she was a ghost. She's like, oh my God, I'm dead.
I didn't know that about that. Yeah, I didn't know she went for.
Look how he sits forward now. Look, he's just like,
oh, no, because I'm
a trick on white people. Yeah.
On black people.
All blacks, yeah. Right. He did the same with like a zombie thing where he's like,
yeah, I saw
with
that
a machine
one.
In a pub, and the guy's with the zombie, and he does a series of flashes,
yeah,
and then
yeah.
It makes him pass out, and then they take him to another location across the street where they've set it up like part of the zombie game, but he wakes up and he's in it holding a gun. And then he has to like shoot the zombies and his shit. You've never seen this before. I'm gonna show you afterwards.
I've never really watched it.
Darren Brown Trick or Treat. Yeah, holy shit.
He used to really make
it. It was like mid 2000s, right?
Yeah.
Like, it was like when Channel 4 was good. When
Channel
4 was like
popping.
Whipping out like just before they started whipping out Inbetweeners and Phone Shop and stuff. It was like just them good like fucking shows that Darren Brown was doing.
They were willing to take risks.
Yeah.
It was alright.
Cool.
Good.
Cool.
All right. I'm gonna talk about these things and I think we're gonna wrap it up. How long's our time?
Three minutes left.
All right.
1 minute, sorry.
1 minute. All right, okay. Well, this will take us over a minute, but I just want to see. All right, top 10 movie bad guys that I thought of, right? Okay, cool. So, I'm going to turn...
Now, when you say that the top your top 10, what are they? Why are they...
I'll tell you. Okay. Well, okay. Well, you'll know... I'm going to start off with the first 9.
Yeah.
Okay, so in like no real particular order for these 9... Apart from like the last ones, I guess the last three, so the first 6, no particular order, right?
Yeah.
And tell me what you think about this. All right. So, Jack Nicholson's the Joker. Did you guys think? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
It the clown.
Aren't you going to say hello?
Oh.
But the Tim Curry.
Yeah. Tim Curry.
Penny oh, yeah, yeah. That's the one that scared me.
Yeah, okay. Hans Gruber.
Now I have a machine gun. Ho, ho, ho.
A security guard we missed?
They're usually tired of policemen growing fat on a pension. No, this is something else.
Ooh, yeah, played by Alan Rickman.
Yeah.
You still good on that?
Yep.
I'm surprised he's not in the top three.
Green. Oh, wait till you hear my top three. Okay. Green Goblin.
Peter, Peter, Peter. No good deed goes unpunished. You can thank me later.
From No Way Home, Willem Dafoe. From like, but that specific one though.
From No Way
from
Home.
From No Way Home. Not from the other ones, because in No Way Home he's extra raw. Because spoiler alert.
Yeah.
He kills Aunt May, innit? So
it's a good thing Satch is watching this.
T-1000.
I'm out!
Now,
really a villain?
Yes, really a villain.
But why?
Because he's calculated,
he killed,
bro.
Think about it, right? He killed the step parents, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but.
But think about the way he did it. And he was like, on the phone. When he's on the phone, and he was like, and he'd be like, oh, shut that dog up. Dun.
Hey, shut up, you worthless piece of shit.
The dog's really barking.
Thought you were going to tell the kid to get rid of that fucking mutt.
John, honey, it's late. Please don't make me worry.
Boom. Right? Yeah, with the knife.
And
yeah.
He was just like, oh, yeah. And he was just like, yeah.
Wolfie's fine.
Wolfie's
honey.
Fine, baby.
Wolfie's just fine.
Where are you?
Yeah.
He's calculating, bro.
And if you've seen the extended version, when he goes to the house and he's touching everything,
oh yeah, yeah,
that's some that, serial killer shit, mm-hmm. right? But I understand why he was doing
like,
it.
He isn't like Christina Loken though, when she touches, when she like sees him and starts coming. Do you remember? She, yeah, Christina Loken in Terminator 3, she touches something from him or sees something and she's like, oh. You don't remember?
I've only seen Terminator 3 twice.
Yeah, she does that. She like proper like, she's about to, she looks like she's about to orgasm. Like she does it and like the internet noise plays.
Alright, so yeah, T-1000.
So T-1000,
yeah,
alright, okay. Then, so we start coming down to the top, the last five, right?
Yeah.
Christoph Waltz as Hans Landa.
You're sheltering enemies of the state, are you not?
Yes.
You're sheltering them underneath your floorboards, aren't you?
Yes.
Point out to me the areas where they're hiding.
Yes!
From Inglourious Basterds.
Definitely.
Darth Vader?
If you only knew the power of the dark side, Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough! He told me you killed him.
No. I am your father.
Yep.
Of course.
Mm-hmm.
Shang Tsung.
Your brother's soul is mine. You will be next.
Played by Cary Hiroyuki Sagawa.
From
Mortal Kombat 95.
Yeah.
Last two, Clarence Boddicka.
See, I got this problem. Cops don't like me, so I don't like cops.
Well, give the man a hand.
Cutwood Smith, Clarence Boddicka from
RoboCop 1.
Bitches.
Oh, of course.
See, the more you say those things, the more you're like, yeah, he belongs there.
Yeah.
Because he is, right?
Yeah, definitely.
And then, so my honorable mentions are, because that's the top nine, right?
Yeah.
So we've got top nine, Joker, Jack Nicholson, Pennywise the Clown, Tim Curry, Hans Gruber, Alan Rickman, Green Goblin, by Willem Dafoe from No Way Home, T-1000, Hans Lander, Christoph Waltz, right? Darth Vader, by, so Darth Vader, James Earl Jones and David Prowse.
Yes.
David Prowse, if people don't know, is the body double. James Earl Jones did voice. Some people don't know that. So, Shang Tsung.
Yep.
By Cary Hiroyuki Tagawa, which is from Mortal Kombat
95.
And Clarence Boddicka, played by Kurtwood Smith in the first RoboCop movie.
Yes.
Right. Okay. All right,
that's a good list.
Now, my honorable mentions, and it is long.
I hope. There's one name I'm hoping to hear in these
honorable mentions. Okay, honorable mentions, and this is going to be speed round.
Yeah.
So we're going to go through them. Biff Tannen.
Yeah.
Played by Tom Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people forget about Biff. Sleep on Biff.
I don't.
Motherfucker chased, but the thing is, a lot of people do though.
Okay.
He chased him through time, bro.
Yeah, quite literally.
Harry and Marv from Home Alone 2 and 1 and 2. Joe Pesci and Daniel Stern. Angelica from Rugrats.
Yeah.
Played by Cheryl Chase.
I mean, she's just a woman.
No, she's a kid.
Yeah, but
she's a villain. Yeah. TV villain.
Yeah, I suppose. I mean, yeah.
I think we've discussed it before, but we're going to get onto.
You're going to say Angelica. Hey Arnold, right?
No, about Angelica later.
Houston.
No. Okay. Character Angelica.
Okay.
Rita Repulsa.
Yep.
Okay.
By Machiko Soga, voiced by Barbara Sega. Alan Rickman again, but as the Sheriff of Nottingham.
Yes.
From fucking Robin Hood Princess
Thieves.
Cancel Christmas. Right, okay, so Detective Alonzo from Training Day. Denzel Washington.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty shitty.
Freddy Krueger.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The only reason I didn't really put him in was because I'm like, I don't feel like he's too supernatural.
Okay.
Whereas like Pennywise is supernatural, but everyone else on that list is kind of like, I guess, could exist real human-wise.
Mm-hmm.
But then like, I don't put Jason, Mike, or Ghostface on there.
Right.
At all.
Because
they have no personality.
Yeah.
Like, there's no real personality to Mike or Jason. They just exist. And then like, and then Ghostface is not one guy. Person. It's multiple people. So it's a moniker versus like, just one dude. So I don't really...
Yeah, makes sense.
Calvin Candy.
Yeah.
Joe over here, Calvin Candy. So
Laughing Stevens West of Calvin.
He didn't make my top 10, but only because he wasn't in the film long enough.
Who's Calvin Candy?
Calvin Candy. Leonardo DiCaprio.
Okay.
I would say Steven is worse than Calvin.
Yeah. I didn't put him on the list, but that's a good point, Hannibal Lecter, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah.
He's not really the villain in that film.
Yeah.
Because Buffalo Bill is, but... But okay.
He's just as vicious.
Listen, he made a motherfucker eat his tongue because he flipped cum on Clarice. I was like, you didn't leave your cell. You just spoke to the dude and you made him do that. That's pressure.
Yeah.
Well, he's a psychiatrist. So. Right, okay. Thanos, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
From Josh, played by Josh Brolin. This one's a bit out of pocket. Definitely didn't make the top 10, but I still think it's valid. To mention Sebastian Kane, Hollow Man, played by Kevin Bacon.
What he did
in that movie when he became invisible and then started raping chicks.
Yeah, but I listened to Paul Verhoeven's discussion about that, and I totally believe him. If you gave that option to any man or any person, they would do unspeakable things. Because
he says it in the damn trailer. He says it's amazing what you can do when you don't have to see yourself in a mirror.
Yeah.
Also, he also calls himself God.
Okay, so he has a complex.
He has that. Right, okay, so next, Davy Jones by Bill Nighy.
I mean, is he really evil, though?
Well, this is what I'm saying, though. Was Hollow Man really evil? Like, that's why they don't make the list.
Okay. Yeah, gotcha.
Darth Maul, obviously, because Ray Park.
Number one henchman.
But the problem is he's got no personality. He's just there with the double lightsabers, right? Okay. Agent Smith from Trilogy of Matrix, right?
I would have put him in the top 10.
You would have put, fair enough. This is my top 10, so fuck you. Right, okay, so.
I love that.
Ivan Drago, played by Dolph Lundgren, but by extension also the country of Russia.
Yeah.
when he just said, I'm sorry, like, as a child, seeing, like, Apollo Creed dead, and he's just looking at it like, if he dies, he dies.
Deep. All right. Lord Frieza from Dragon Ball Z. Mostly because of he's well racist. He's like you. He's so racist. He's always calling Saiyans monkeys.
Yeah.
Hello, monkeys.
I wish I knew Dragon Ball more.
It's okay. You don't like cool things. It's fine. Jeremy Irons as Scar from Lion King.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Definitely.
Annie Wilkes from Misery.
Oh, jeez.
Played by Kathy Bates. Lord Voldemort.
Mm-hmm.
Ralph Fiennes from Harry Potter.
Yeah.
Jack Torrance. Played by Jack Nicholson in The Shining. Some of these are on here because I needed some inspiration to make sure that I'd got a good list.
Yeah.
And they mentioned stuff that I was like, oh, they're good. They're not on my list, but they are on somebody's list, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
And if this list was longer of the top 10, then yeah. But we're almost done. Pazuzu.
Yes.
Or Regan McNeil, right? Pazuzu from
Exorcist.
I mean,
if you're going to go for evil, that's literally the original
definition
evil.
Definition of it.
Yeah.
The xenomorph from Alien?
No, even, no, I wouldn't put it in any.
That's just an animal.
Any category.
It's an animal, but it's a villain.
It's a thing.
It's a villain.
Yeah. It's a thing that has that wants to do one thing.
Eat and kill. Yeah.
Yeah.
Nurse Ratched from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Oh yeah, definitely evil.
Norman Bates from Psycho. Mm-hmm. And lastly, Joker, Heath Ledger from mm-hmm. The Dark Knight.
Yeah.
So those are the honorable mentions. Mm-hmm. But number one for me mm-hmm. goes to.
But why? Why do they still call me a warlord? And mad? All I want to do is to create the perfect genetic soldier. Not for power, not for evil, but for good. Carlos Blanca will be the first of many. They shall march out of my laboratory and sweep away every adversary, every creed, every nation, until the very planet is in the loving grip of the Pax Bisonica. And that peace will reign in the world. All humanity shall bow to me in humble gratitude.
That was beautiful.
Raul Julia in Street Fighter as General M. Bison. I can't not put that as number one. He is the best villain in my eyes. Tell me, I can defend it, but I think it's obvious. If you just watch that movie, you'll see he is the best villain in that entire thing. I think he's my favorite villain anyway. Like, I just love how he chews the furniture, chews the scenery, everything he's in.
I mean,
and when he does that monologue, when he talks about Tuesday. Like, no, not even that. But do you see how memorable that line is? Like, that line. Like, the day that Bison graced your village was the most important day of your life. But to me, it was Tuesday.
It was 20 years ago. You hadn't promoted yourself to general yet. You were just a petty drug lord. You and your gang of murderers gathered your small ounce of courage to raid across the border for food, weapons, slave labor. My father was the village magistrate. A simple man with a simple code, justice. He gathered the few people that he could to stand against you. You and your bullies were driven back by farmers with pitchforks. My father saved his village at the cost of his own life. You had him shot as you ran away. A hero at 1,000 paces.
I'm sorry. I don't remember any of it.
You don't remember?
For you. The day Bison graced your village was the most important day of your life. But for me, it was Tuesday.
Like, do you understand that line is like synonymous with just like just dropping a mic on someone?
Yeah.
Like, yeah. And Raul Julia, like, he's in Presumed Innocent, the film with Harrison Ford. So those are my top 10 plus all the honorable mentions. Your task is to now the supporting actor to the main character, mm-hmm. best top 10, and honorable mentions as you want to put them.
Okay.
So give us that next time we're on there, and then yeah, we're gonna close it out because I'm dying. It's hot.
I'm disappointed that there was one name that didn't make.
What was the name?
David Lopan.
Oh, from
Lopan.
Lopan. Yeah. Yes. You know what? I haven't watched that film enough. But you were right. It is on there. I should have put it on there. It wouldn't be on my top 10.
Yeah, it'd have been honorable. But
it'd be honorable mention. Yeah, for sure. Lopan. Yeah. He's still alive, that motherfucker, you know? James Ho.
Yeah, I know. He just did a voiceover for a game that, he's still doing work. He still works.
I've always known him. You guys probably know him from, Big Trouble in Little China. But me, I've always known him as Tia Carrera's dad. Cassandra's dad in Wayne's World 2. And then Wayne kicks him in the nuts and then these two brass balls fall out. Remember that shit.
Wayne's World 2 is very underrated.
Yeah, it's a great fucking movie, dude.
Yeah, it's very
underrated. It's got Robert Patrick in it.
Yeah, it does.
No, he's in the first one.
Have you seen this boy?
Yeah. All right, guys, well, listen. How far have we got into it?
11 minutes.
11 minutes. Right. Hour, 11 minutes. One day we'll do the hour, but we love you. Mm-hmm. Fucking, I'm dying of heat here, but we're going to edit this and get it out to you as soon as possible. And big love to you all. Please like and subscribe. Share it with your friends. Tell them it's not safe for work. And I've been L.
I've been Nil.
That's Joe with the color of his skin.
It's Uncle Ruckus.
Uncle Ruckus over here. Just say your byes.
Goodbye.
Bye. We love you. Bye.
Goodbye. Bye-bye.
No.
You
can't.
No.
Can I pick that doll?
No, he's sleeping.
Can I pick that doll?
Zang.